on this edition of In the Life.
A new home for gay history. Comedian Marga Gomez proposes a gay holiday.
Hello, ladies.
And a musical master's lush life.
Musically, he was an immeasurable influence on generations.
Plus, 20 years later, the impact of AIDS on the arts. All this and more on the season premiere of In the Life, America's gay and lesbian news magazine.
In the Life is funded in part by the H. Van Amringen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Overbrook Foundation, the Gill Foundation, James Johnson, William J. Resnick, Barry Skovgaard and Mark Walensky, the Terry K. Watanabe Charitable Trust, Peter Zimmer and Jim Stepp, the Arcus Foundation, Beaulieu Vineyard, celebrating over 100 years of passionate winemaking and proudly supporting In the Life, Beaulieu Vineyard, Rutherford, California, and the annual support of In the Life members like you.
Welcome to In the Life and the premiere of our 10th season. I'm Katherine Linton. In the Life debuted in 1992, 5 years before Ellen came out, and way before Will met Grace. Since then, we've evolved from a gay variety show to an Emmy-nominated news magazine. In celebration of our 10th anniversary, we'll be introducing a number of new elements throughout the season, like humorous commentary by celebrity guests, and even some new faces. We're here at Joe's Pub, a nightclub at the famed Public Theater in New York. Joe's Pub headlines some of today's most innovative performers, including many from the world of jazz. Therefore, we felt it would be the perfect place to introduce to you one of jazz's best-kept secrets. Later in the episode, we'll profile Billy Strayhorn, the man behind some of Duke Ellington's most popular music. Correspondent David Martin takes us on a visit to a new archive and research center on gay and lesbian life. Andy Hum is out and about. And comedian Marga Gomez speaks out for a new national holiday.
It's my favorite holiday of the year.
But first, AIDS and the profound impact this epidemic has had on the arts. For two decades now, AIDS has ravaged the artistic community, claiming the lives of well-known performers like actor Rock Hudson, choreographer Avalon Ailey, and singer Freddie Mercury. And for every celebrity, there are thousands of other artists who've died before reaching their full potential. From the beginning, artists have also been at the forefront of the battle against AIDS, using their creativity to ignite activism and help us all deal with loss, fear, and frustration. Numerous organizations are honoring the voices and visions of some of these gifted artists, ensuring that their work will not be forgotten. Jack Waters is a New York-based filmmaker, writer, and dancer who was diagnosed with HIV in 1992. In honor of Gay Pride this past summer, New York City's Donnell Library commissioned Waters and his partner, Peter Cramer, to install their exhibit called Pride 2001 in a window of the library.
It's a three-channel video installation and photographs that are my photographs and also archival material from various gay and lesbian publications.
So what we were working on conceptually was the idea of AIDS and AIDS history, but especially about how it's become erased from the popular consciousness.
To assist artists like Jack Waters, the advocacy group Alliance for the Arts founded the Estate Project for Artists with AIDS in 1991.
It was founded to assist families and survivors in preserving the work of artists that were being directly affected by the epidemic. And artists in the broadest sense, performing arts, visual arts, literature, dance, filmmaking, etc. Jack Waters is one of the artists whose films we've had the opportunity to preserve and master in the film preservation program.
Jack, are you there? Jackie, are you there?
I have been active in the AIDS HIV movement since the mid-80s. since my friends started getting sick and dying. Getting an HIV diagnosis is a major life change. And being an artist, of course, it changes the way one approaches one's art. For me, in retrospect, I would say that the thing that's really changed the most as being HIV positive and diagnosed with AIDS is this idea that there's not that much time.
Let me try and explain the impetus for starting the Estate Project for Artists with AIDS. A lot of people in society were reeling at that time in the early 90s from the cumulative impact of AIDS. And in the midst of all of that, we in the arts became aware of what we understood as a secondary loss. The first loss was, of course, of people. But we began to realize that when those people were artists, there was a double loss. The art itself that they created, their most personal and lasting expression, was cut off because of the shortness of their lives.
And of course, in many of those cases, that the subject of that work became AIDS and, itself, or the epidemic, or death, or mortality itself, which certainly would not have been the case if they had lived a normal lifespan.
Currently, the focus of the Estate Project is primarily archival. They have launched the online virtual collection in partnership with Visual AIDS, the only national organization that provides direct services to HIV-positive visual artists and documents their work in the largest archive of its kind. In addition, the Estate Project has archives for dance and musical works in the making, work that in many cases would have otherwise been lost.
I've known and known of many artists who have died of AIDS before they've had an opportunity to make plans for their artwork after they've died. When that has happened, many times there develop tremendous fights between gallery owners and family members as who has the rights to the work. And as a result of that, the tragic result of that is that oftentimes the work gets lost, it gets discarded, it gets held up in litigation, it dies.
As the culmination of its first decade of work, the Estate Project produced Loss Within Loss, which was edited by prominent out-gay writer Edmund White, who is himself HIV positive.
Loss Within Loss is a subtitle, The Artist in the Age of AIDS, and it's a collection of essays by various people about those in the arts who have died of AIDS. A lot of the essays are about artists who were not known. In general, if the artists whom we know and revere had died before age 40, we would never have heard of their names. And so we have the beginnings of careers and the beginnings of reputations, but the danger of these people being forgotten entirely.
One of the contributors to Loss Within Loss is writer and activist Sarah Shulman.
Well, you know, I think there was a dominant aesthetic to AIDS art at a certain era, the end of the 80s. The chaos, the panic, the sadness, the desperation that you see in AIDS art that's made right at the height of the crisis. Work that's not finished, that's sloppy, that's a mess because the people are a mess, because everyone's upset, because no one knows what to do. In a sense, formally, that is the most authentic representation of the emotion.
AIDS certainly brought about an interest in the two great themes of human existence, love and death. And I think it was remarkable that there was that kind of serious focus that was suddenly brought to these two subjects in the gay community, because the gay community, like the rest of America, was sort of almost too jokey to talk about love and death phobic. So it took something as extraordinary as AIDS to finally break this taboo.
The publication of Loss Within Loss, which marks the 10th anniversary of the Estate Project, also coincides with another anniversary. In 2001, GMHC, or Gay Men's Health Crisis, turns 20. GMHC was founded in New York City in 1981 by a group of gay men as the first organization in the world to fight AIDS. As a reminder of the contributions that artists have made to the struggle against AIDS, GMHC commissioned an art exhibit at the Museum of the City of New York this past summer.
The show is a collection of a variety of objects. You have from posters to photographs to personal mementos that people have had, to critical announcements and press releases. The initial art that we remember is art by white male artists. It is not the case throughout the epidemic, as it unfortunately evolved and continued to expanding into other communities. So did the artists' works, you know? Artists from all communities, black artists, Latino artists, women, have participated, produced, and continue to this day to do that.
AIDS, a Living Archive, is based on a documentary project. Its two curators, Jane Rosette and Jean Carlamusto, have worked on the exhibit for 5 years.
A lot of what Jean and I are doing is exploring that and something actually, you know, sort of the relationship between what happens when you create activist propaganda and means of communication, and then it becomes, that very piece becomes a document, and then it becomes an artifact, and then it's seen as art.
The direct consequences of AIDS, the suffering and death of artists of every discipline, left its mark on the art of the 80s and 90s. But even if a cure were found tomorrow, the impact of AIDS on the arts will be felt for decades to come.
Now we have a generation of people my age who have had a profound experience with death, and in great quantity. And here we are, middle-aged, facing the second halves of our lives, and I think that we do all of that very differently than we would have without that loss that came before. And the way that aging will be represented in the artwork that we make will always be determined by the experiences that we had at the height of the AIDS crisis.
Edmund White has given us award-winning and provocative literature since the 1970s and helped to blaze a trail for other gay authors like me. He's also been instrumental in the war against AIDS. In 1981, before AIDS even had a name, White co-founded an organization called the Gay Men's Health Crisis, better known as GMHC. This institution has provided a place for our community to learn about the disease, to mount a battle against it, and to take care of each other in its wake. Despite some major breakthroughs in treatment, the fight against AIDS is far from over. We still need places like GMHC, and they need our support. To find the link to GMHC, go to the End the Life website at endthelifetv.org. Check it out and get involved. I'm Elon Harris, and you're watching End the Life.
This drawing, this publication, this magazine. There was a time when having any one of these items would put you at risk of being ostracized, fired from your job, even arrested. The people who gathered and preserved these artifacts faced just those threats and more, but it still did not dissuade them from their goal of documenting the lives and memories of gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered people.
With numerous bookstores and hundreds of publications now serving the gay and lesbian community, it's hard to imagine that only 50 years ago, the U.S. Post Office had to be instructed by the Supreme Court to deliver items with gay and lesbian content. And while millions of people now take to the streets for gay pride every year, it took decades of struggle to make such celebrations possible.
You know, in those days, I used to think I was crazy because I was gay. I was attracted to women, and there were no books to look at.
There were the days of a lot of persecution and police brutality and really bad days, difficult days.
I'm old enough, I'm 53, I'm old enough to remember the bad old days before the movement and how isolated we were, how without a support system we were, whether it was political or personal.
So I read all the things about it, and so I thought I was a pervert, you see, and I thought, gee, what kind of life have I got?
And all through that period, then the archive kept the history, kept the stories. And today they're all here. This is collective memory.
This memory is now preserved in the new home of the One Institute and International Gay and Lesbian Archives. Over 50 years in the making, One is now located in a building donated by the University of Southern California. Part library, museum archive, research center, and art gallery. It represents the largest collection in the world of historical material documenting the life experience of gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered people.
There were three major collections that originally were separate that have a very interesting checkered history as the community evolved. Jim Kepner's collection started in the late 1940s. He collected, as he told me once, because he went into some of the biggest public libraries in the U.S. and he couldn't find anything on homosexuals.
Now, Jim, I consider him one of the greatest people in the gay movement. Jim lived and breathed his homosexuality. He believed in freedom. He believed in gay freedom. It was his vision that the archives is the great archives it is today.
In addition to Jim Kepner's vast collection, the other two main holdings that came together to create the current archives were the One Incorporated collection and the collection of the Homosexual Information Center.
These were people who, back in the 1950s, decided that they simply weren't going to put up with being in the closet. Their political activity in publishing One magazine, in organizing the Mattachine Society, in organizing discussion groups that became a model for the movement which spread all across the United States.
Most people think that the gay movement began in 1969 with Stonewall, but in fact it was here in Los Angeles in 1950. And so One became the leading organization in the 50s that really propelled a lot of the research. And One magazine was a preeminent magazine of what they called the homophile community from 1953 up to 1967 when The Advocate was founded.
In 1954, One magazine brought suit against the U.S. Postal Service for refusing to deliver their publication. 4 years later, One's long court battle resulted in the first U.S. Supreme Court decision in favor of a gay organization and laid the basis for the rise of a free gay and lesbian press.
So they expanded beyond being just a publication for a magazine to also do research and education.
So what I tell people is in the 70s, I work with lesbian feminists. In the 80s, with lesbians of color. And in the 90s and into the 21st century, I'm a lesbian history and visibility activist.
Yolanda Redder oversees the Lesbian Legacy Collection at the Archives.
I think it's important that every community, especially what I call target communities, oppressed communities, collect their history. And unlike every other community, our history is more deeply buried. And even within our own LGBT community, we've got a pecking order. The history of women, the history of people of color is even more deeply buried than the white man's history. And I'm always collecting materials pertaining to people of color in all these areas. So that is very different. The lesbian of color focus is very different here. This particular project, the collection of our history, is a big enough tent that anybody can be accommodated here. I don't care if I don't agree with your politics. You are invited to place your records, your materials, your history in this collection. So it's good karma. It's a good karma project.
Many of those who have served the One Institute also have some history there, including the Reverend Flo Fleischman, who founded the Manhattan Beach, California chapter of the Daughters of Bilitis.
You'll see a photo of me in the first apartment where I had the first meeting. I brought my camera and I said, please, let's take a picture of all of us together. They refused. Nobody wanted to have their picture taken because they were afraid of being arrested and going to jail. And so they said, well, let's take a picture of you, Flo. I said, yeah, I'm not afraid. So they took a picture of me, and that's why there's only me there. But they said, at least we have a record of our movement.
Younger people walk in here, and they're like, they barely have heard of Stonewall. They do need to have something around which to focus their identity, their heritage. And ours has been so lost, so destroyed, so undervalued, so underplayed.
If there isn't a repository that is dedicated to gay and lesbian material, a lot of very well-meaning relatives and friends even will take material like this and they'll destroy it. They'll think this is private, this may be an embarrassment, this is something we have to get rid of.
So how much of our history has been erased, thrown out, or hidden? So I'm on a mission here to collect it, preserve it, put it on the internet.
We have scholars coming all the time from all over the world to see it and to know, look, here's a history of a people that really hasn't been told.
It leaves me stuttering and speechless when I think about exactly how many different books could be written out of this archive. Lesbian and gay grad students of the future are going to have a lot of work to do and some place to do it.
Plus, they come here and they see their history, you know? So it's not just about information, it's about inspiration. You know, people from all different segments of the community, different generations, come here and they say, I feel like I'm home.
Why I'm so active in one, and why I've always been active in one, is because I saw what its potential was to give us gays a heritage. And that is what the archives gives us, roots.
Sarah Orne Jewett, Henry Gerber, the Stonewall Inn, Bayard Rustin, the assassination of Harvey Milk. These people and events are part of a legacy rarely mentioned in traditional history books. Same-sex relationships have been part of the social and political landscape since the very beginning. And while historians have begun to recover evidence of gay and lesbian lives from throughout the past, parts of the story remain untold. In response, gay men and lesbians have created libraries and archives across the country. Major collections include the Lesbian History Archives in New York, the One Institute and Archives in Los Angeles, and the James C. Hormel Gay and Lesbian Center of the San Francisco Public Library. To find a library or archive in your area, look for a link on the In the Life website at inthelifetv.org. I'm Alec Mapa, and you're watching In the Life.
Throughout this, our 10th season, In the Life will be bringing back some of our most compelling stories from previous seasons, award-winning pieces of which we're especially proud. This next segment first aired in 1998 when Hurricane Mitch devastated much of Central America, killing thousands of people and destroying millions of dollars worth of property. Nicaragua was one of the countries hardest hit by the hurricane and received financial aid to help it rebuild. But some women in the small town of Condega didn't qualify for assistance and were left homeless. In response, two groups of women, many of them lesbians, transcended language, culture, and national boundaries to help these women rebuild their homes while building coalitions.
My name is Margarita Suarez, and I started the Condega Homemakers Project, which is sending women's building brigades to Nicaragua. We're going down to Nicaragua to help a group called La Asociación Colectivo de Mujeres Constructoras, which means the Collective Association of Women Construction Workers. They teach courses in carpentry, ironwork, and building construction. We've gotten a lot of support from the gay and lesbian community, and I think that's really interesting because we didn't start the group as a lesbian group. The leadership of the group is lesbian. I identify as lesbian, and a lot of my connections are through the lesbian community. Getting the gay and lesbian community to support this project is important because I think it's just really important for people who are committed to struggle to realize that the struggle is really grand and there are ways in which our struggles here in the United States pale in comparison to a natural disaster leaving, you know, killing 10,000 people and leaving thousands and thousands of people homeless in Nicaragua. So it's a way to channel our energies and find a connection between us and the women in Condega.
Thank you.
Bueno, en la década de los 80, ¿verdad? Estuvo aquí una brigada de Estados
Unidos. Well, in the 1980s, an American brigade came to build a school. To help them build that school, they recruited local women, just like we do now.
Mujeres de la localidad para hacer la escuela. Yo soy lesbiana.
I'm a lesbian. To this day, we owe the infrastructure of our group to that network of lesbian women. Our contact with lesbian women has allowed us to form an international network of volunteers who support this project unconditionally. As far as the objective of our group, we state our objective like this: to contribute to diminish the lack of gender equality in the field of labor. For a woman's self-esteem, it is very important for her to look back and note what she has accomplished. It's not enough that she has a new piece of furniture, but that she be proud to have made it herself.
Well, being here during the hurricane was very, very scary. We heard there was going to be a hurricane passing through Honduras. We were told that it wasn't going to affect Nicaragua, or the rain that we were having was because of this hurricane. So we were just on the tail end of it. And then it was one Wednesday morning. We woke up and the alarms had already gone off, or the church bells had already gone off. It was a whole block that was washed away.
¿Y cuántas casas estuvieron aquí?
Nosotros contamos como ciento y pico por toda.
People were just staying in their houses because they just didn't believe that they would have to get out, and they didn't want to get out, because if they left their houses, that would mean that they were kind of accepting the fact that they might be washed away with all their things.
Fue algo terrible.
It was horrible. We never expected such destruction. We were afraid when the storm began, and we asked God to please protect us. My house was here, where we are standing now. It was 10 yards wide by 15 yards long. It had a big living room, two bedrooms, a kitchen, a nice bathroom. I had lived here for 20 years. Now that Mitch has left me homeless, I'm very depressed, because I'd never been without a place to live. I've never even had to rent. It's terrible to lose your house and be left with nothing after so many years.
Well, we, Mujeres Constructoras and the Red to Mujeres, which is a network of women, hoping to build 25 houses. That's our aim. That's what we have the funding for at the moment. We've been playing with all the budget and trying to see if we can maybe build more in the future, or maybe if bits more money come in, then we can build more houses. And the Brigadistas, they've got their own project and they're applying for funding.
We want to build 25 or 30 houses. We need to get $3,500 each for the houses, because that's how much the town determined the house would cost. We need to find women to come and help build the houses.
Seeing the devastation, just first seeing, laying eyes on the devastation from the hurricane was pretty profound.
As gay men and lesbians, or as queer people in the society, we're often fighting against the status quo. We're trying to make conditions better, make life easier for people.
I think all the battles are connected. I think there's no such thing as separating them out.
I think that the only way that any of these particular groups really makes change in the world is when we see those connections and when we work with one another.
I am very grateful to both organizations because they have both stood by me since the moment I lost my house. I have faith in God that I'm going to pass the class at the workshop, that I'm going to remain employed there. That makes me happy, because during these hard times, it is very hard to be without a job. We need work in order to move forward.
I feel so much like I have so much to learn from these women who have been through so much more than I have.
Perhaps they're going to teach us things, but we're going to teach them new things as well.
There are an awful lot of us, especially gay and lesbian people, who have plenty of energy and resources, you know, financial and otherwise, that we could be giving a lot. We could be giving so much more. And even though, even if we're not necessarily working on things that are specifically gay and lesbian, we're still furthering our own cause by making real, sustainable, lasting change in the world. You know, I have to believe that. I've seen so much evidence of it.
Since this segment first aired, the Condega Homemakers Project was able to secure over $70,000 in private donations and foundation grants, which funded the construction of more than 15 houses in Nicaragua. There is now a new women's neighborhood, a block and a half of houses inhabited by beneficiaries and their families, many of whom assisted in the building of their own homes.
Hi, I'm Wesley Snipes.
Hello, I'm Susan Sarandon.
This is Petula Clark.
Pete Seeger.
David Marshall Grant.
Quentin Criz.
Jason Alexander.
We're Betty.
And you're watching.
You're watching.
America's Emmy-nominated gay and lesbian news magazine.
In the Life.
In the Life.
In the Life.
Now, I think that's fabulous.
Still to come on In the Life. The man behind Duke Ellington and some of his most enduring music, and outtakes with Marga Gomez. But first.
Lesbians challenge a pro basketball team. Thespians gather for a conference on gay theater, and a gay community center reopens. We'll brief you on these stories and more as we bring you news and cultural events in our new series, Out and About.
On June 21st, the body of Native American transgender youth Fred Martinez was found in a small desert canyon near his home in Cortez, Colorado. The 16-year-old had been severely beaten and left to die. Fred, also known as Frederica or FC, was last seen on the evening of June 16th. That same night, an acquaintance, 18-year-old Sean Murphy, boasted to friends that he had just beat up a fag. His clothes were covered in blood. Murphy has been arrested, though the police were slow to label the murder a hate crime. Most major national dailies have not picked up this story. If not for lesbian, gay, and transgender activist groups, we might never have heard about this senseless murder. In the Life, we'll be tracking this story as events unfold. This summer, audiences gathered in Southampton, New York to hear three award-winning gay playwrights, Edward Albee, Terrence McNally and Lanford Wilson discuss gay theater. The panel was organized by the East End Gay Organization.
Our topic today is theater from a gay perspective.
Terrence McNally was quick to point out the pitfalls of pigeonholing gay writers.
It's very convenient for a critic to call the three of us gay writers because it's a little compartment. Imagine how absurd it would be to call Arthur Miller and David Mamet
straight writers.
Still shows how marginalized gay men and lesbians are by our society.
These writers said they also have to battle expectations that they ought to write only gay material.
When I read a review that says Lanford Wilson should have had more gay stuff in his play, I get very angry at that because these criticisms come from the gay community, not from anyone else. And I think it's his diversity or Edward's diversity that should be celebrated by
us. Yes, but there are some critics and some people in the audience who feel that if a playwright happens to be gay, he is not equipped to properly write about heterosexuals. I mean, we're supposed to be able to write about anything.
I know.
Well, I'm convinced that playwrights who happen to be gay over the centuries have written extraordinarily well about both men and women. I'm trying to think of many times when I have found straight playwrights who have written as fully and completely, sympathetically and honestly about gays. Maybe we have an additional advantage being gay.
I've always thought that. I feel perfectly comfortable at my typewriter being a woman. And I can't imagine David Mamet doing that, you know?
It's not enough to write a gay play anymore to get an audience. I'd say, wouldn't you say 20 years ago, there was a gay audience sort of built in for things?
Oh, yeah.
Like there were gay restaurants. And now you can open and say, it's a gay restaurant. So is the food any good? So yeah. Is the play any good? Which is how it should be. That's what I mean by progress.
Lesbians for Liberty is an ad hoc group of lesbian WNBA fans who are demanding that the New York Liberty, New York's WNBA team, do more to recognize its devoted lesbian fan base.
I was coming to the games and realizing that there were so many lesbian fans here and that the Garden really did nothing to acknowledge our presence.
Liberty refused to acknowledge that they have thousands of lesbian fans, that their fan base is based on lesbians.
I mean, if you can give out a mug for Father's Day, you can say, Happy Lesbian and Gay Pride Day.
I feel very invisible. I'm tired of it just being Madison Square Closet.
I think that the logical course of action for next season, if we don't have the acknowledgement and recognition that we feel we deserve from all of the teams in the WNBA, is to organize and boycott those teams that we feel aren't acknowledging the lesbian fan base.
At New York's Dixon Place, cartoonist Howard Cruse and science fiction writer Samuel Delany read from their new work. Cruse's Wendell series ran continuously throughout the 1980s in The Advocate. The entire 129 episodes have been collected for the first time in a single volume.
Here's Wendell's fantasy. Notice the newspaper headline. Previously unpublished writer awarded Nobel Prize for Literature.
Celebrated gay author Samuel Delany read from his book of collected letters entitled 1984. Opening this fall is the award-winning comedy The Iron Ladies, based on the true story of a Thai male volleyball team whose mostly gay and transgender members won the national championship in 1996. Revolving around two gay volleyball players and their lesbian coach, The Iron Ladies won the Audience Award for Best Feature at both the New York and San Francisco Gay and Lesbian Film Festivals. The New York Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender Community Center recently completed a $12 million renovation on its landmark building in Greenwich Village and reopened its doors to the community. The center is the second largest of its kind in the U.S. and is home to over 300 community groups.
I think it's fantastic. It's airy and beautiful and really welcoming.
Gives the community a focal point.
Again, we're home again.
Here you go, our next generation. Cut away. And open those doors and come on home.
Proposed hate crime legislation relies on accurate statistics of anti-gay violence. That's where you come in. If you've been attacked or even threatened, report the incident to the police. If you don't feel comfortable filing a police report, the Hate Crimes Documentation Network offers a new way to report the incident online, anonymously. For a link to the Hate Crimes Documentation Network and other organizations that offer support, visit In the Life's website at inthelifetv.org. I'm Danny Pintauro, and you're watching In the Life.
Thank you.
Pittsburgh people love their Giants, and he has always been well-known, cherished as one of the great artists the city has produced.
He worked in the shadow of another person for most of his life. Musically, he was an immeasurable influence on generations.
Frank Sinatra wanted to record a Billy Strayhorn. And who was bigger than Frank Sinatra in terms of the music business?
He certainly inspires me as a gay man, as a black man.
When the subject is an artist and the artist is a musician, we must start with the music. And while you might not know his name, we all know his music.
Some of the best stories take the longest time to get told. Billy Strayhorn began his prolific career in the 1930s, but it has taken nearly 75 years for him to be recognized as one of America's greatest composers.
Strayhorn was blessed with a musical gift and bought himself a piano with money that he earned from delivering newspapers in the fifth grade, paid for his own piano lessons, and piles of sheet music that he bought.
David Haydu's 1996 biography called Lush Life has helped revive interest in the music of Billy Strayhorn.
Well, his original dream was to be a classical musician, and he learned pretty quickly that that was out of the question. There was no such thing as a, virtually no such thing as a black classical musician when he graduated from high school in 1932. So he shifted over to jazz early on. By the time he was in his late teens, he had already written a complete musical show, Fantastic Rhythm, that was a tremendous success. He had already written Lush Life, Something to Live For.
The two songs that tell me the most about Billy Strayhorn as a human being as well as an artist are Lush Life and Something to Live For. There's a poignance there that really touches one deeply.
Both Lush Life and Something to Live For were included in a critically acclaimed evening of Strayhorn's music compiled by Darius Tahaz.
Paris will ease the bite of it. All I care is to smile in spite of it.
I wasn't surprised to find out that he was gay. It was more interesting to find out what he had to surmount, overcome, and not apologizing and being unafraid to be who he was.
In Lush Life, say, even the tone of the song, a sense that it would be hard because of all the social pressure.
I'll live a lush life.
That reflected a gay sensibility of a time when life was very difficult. It's an art song of gay life of that period.
So here we have a person with two pretty big strikes against him in those days, being African-American, wanting to write a classical music, being gay on top of that, and then he compounded the problem by deciding early on to not deny his homosexuality.
I want something to live for.
Strayhorn's prolific work as a young musician and composer in Pittsburgh well prepared him for a meeting in 1938 that would alter jazz history forever. One night before Duke Ellington performed, a young Billy Strayhorn got to show off his talents to the jazz great.
Strayhorn was 23 when he met Duke Ellington, and thank God he did. And they spent the next 30 years working very closely together, and their work is inextricable from then on.
Well, I always connected him with Duke Ellington because he was like Duke's right-hand man. Everybody was touched by Billy Strayhorn. I mean, if you were touched by Duke, you had to be touched by Billy Strayhorn.
Andy Bay has sung Strayhorn's music throughout his career.
Why do you haunt me so?
It was Duke who really understood
deep
and really appreciated and really loved Billy Strayhorn, understood where he was coming from musically, who zeroed in right away. I mean, even though he didn't get the credit in some cases until later on, but everything comes out in the wash in the long run.
Little of Strayhorn's story had been told during his lifetime, mostly because he avoided the spotlight as a means of self-protection. Not wanting to deny his homosexuality, it was easier for him to work quietly in the big shadow cast by Duke Ellington. And though he often didn't receive recognition for his work, Strayhorn's collaboration with Ellington provided him with an extraordinary outlet for his talents. He composed and arranged hundreds of songs, including many of the great standards of the Ellington Orchestra.
Joining Ellington also brought Strayhorn to New York City.
When Billy Strayhorn moved to New York, he found an insular world of like-minded spirits who supported each other. His exposure to the world of cafe society in New York was the beginning of a coming of age for Billy Strayhorn as a man, as a gay man.
Shortly after moving to New York in 1939, Strayhorn found companionship for the first time in Aaron Bridgers, and they lived together for over 10 years.
He was one of the few that had the courage to deal with it, take me or leave me. I mean, the fact that he was black, gay, you know, the business is homophobic. I mean, that's, and it still is to this day. So the fact that he got with somebody like Duke, where he was able to express his feelings, his music, it was an opening for him.
Duke Ellington recognized Billy Strayhorn's genius, and he was not encumbered by Billy Strayhorn's homosexuality. And that's a testament to Ellington's accepting Billy Strayhorn utterly regardless of his sexual orientation. I really think that's to Duke's credit.
Cigarette holder, which wigs me.
In 1941, Ellington introduced Billy Strayhorn to a young singer named Lena Horne, and the two became lifelong friends. They also worked and recorded together.
You know, there's a great story about Duke Ellington assigning Billy to watch over Lena Horne. He had his eye on Lena Horne, and he didn't want anyone else to get next to her while he was out of town, so he assigned Billy to the Lena Horne watch, and Lena fell in love with Billy. Of course, there remained a very close friendship. She was the sort of person who respected quality, and she saw the quality in this man, and his talent, and his kindness.
I met him in the middle or late part of 1948 or sometime in 49.
Bill Coleman was a close friend of Strayhorn's for nearly two decades.
And over the years, he began to invite me to recording sessions. In watching Duke and Strayhorn record, when they were writing together or when they were collaborating, I wouldn't hazard a guess as to who was doing what.
And the tremendous respect that the two men had for each other resulted in one of the most precious musical resources in jazz.
The last relationship of Strayhorn's life was with Bill Grove. They had just 3 years together. In 1967, Billy Strayhorn died of cancer in Grove's arms.
Any artist has to be able to turn off the world and be himself. Billy saw a lot of life in those 51 years. It's not so much that you die at a young age, it's what you leave.
At Billy Strayhorn's funeral, Duke Ellington gave the eulogy. And he said nothing mattered more to Billy Strayhorn than the truth.
And I hope that other people will see the wealth of this musical legacy that he left us.
Everything that he is there in that music.
Thank you.
on the next edition of In the Life.
Be sure to tune in for a more in-depth report on the murder of young Fred Martinez.
He was my baby.
And a look at what it's like to be out and on the road with two gay truckers. Next, a new segment we call Outtakes.
In order to increase voter turnout, a bipartisan committee recently proposed making Election Day a national holiday. Yes, we need more voters, but do we really need more national holidays? Is it just me, or are holidays the worst of times for anyone else in the life? Holiday music is completely undanceable. The decorations are tired, and those twinkling lights, unflattering. If Election Day becomes official, that means another obligatory holiday barbecue or turkey dinner with your girlfriend's compassionate conservative relatives. Some holiday. Stress, booze, politics, red meat, and Uncle Bert calling you a damn libertarian all night. Not festive. I'd rather be working. Instead of a bipartisan committee, a bisexual committee should propose the next national holiday using criteria that reflects the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender community. We already have several unofficial huge holidays that I'm sure all Americans would enjoy. For instance, every June, in almost every state of the Union, we celebrate Pride. Now our heterosexual friends can be proud with us. How about National Coming Out Day, which is in October and has been observed for many years, but not by everybody until now? You can begin this special day by telling someone at your church or in your family or your carpool that you are gay. Even if you're not. You know, sometimes I think it might be nice to have a national going-in day for people we wish weren't gay. And Halloween. Hello, that's ours too. Let's make it a three-day weekend. And that goes for the Dinosaur weekend too, ladies. Our community knows how to celebrate. So let us cram America's calendar with special occasions like Lesbian Mother's Day, Oscar Wilde's birthday, Gender Reassignment Day, Queer Independence Day, Mullet Appreciation Week, Cat History Month, and Take Your Ex-Lover to Work Day. Woohoo! For In the Life, I'm Marga Gomez, and that's how it should be. From all of us at In the Life, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next month.
In the Life is funded in part by the H. Van Amringen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Overbrook Foundation, the Gill Foundation, James Johnson, William J. Resnick, Barry Skovgaard and Mark Walensky, the Terry K. Watanabe Charitable Trust, Peter Zimmer and Jim Stepp, the Arcus Foundation, Beaulieu Vineyard, celebrating over 100 years of passionate winemaking and proudly supporting In the Life. Beaulieu Vineyard, Rutherford, California. And the annual support of In the Life members like you.